Coming up next, we have another talk from, we're going to go back to live talks, and it's going to be Fernando Salvetti. Fernando has spoken at the conference for quite a long time, and his work is also high tech and fascinating, but specific to the learning world. Fernando runs a company that produces a product called eReal, and this is a mixed media product, which allows people to do, among other things, simulations in 3D mixed media holographic worlds. You're going to get to see some examples of that and hear from Fernando, who's here a number of times throughout the conference, showing us different examples of the way his product can be used and the kinds of educational experiences he's created in the medical field and in some other fields as well. This particular talk is about leadership, and we're going to start here. So let's go ahead and we're going to run Fernando's intro, and then we'll bring on to Fernando. Right, so we're ready, I think, for Fernando's slides, and Fernando, get Fernando back on camera, and we'll be ready to go with his talk. All right, excellent, everything is there. Fernando, good to see you, and I'm gonna turn the floor over to you. If you have questions for the audience, please, if you have questions, put them in the chat. We will try to work them in if we can, and certainly there'll be a great Q&A session after, and we'll make sure we take care of them then. So welcome again, Fernando Salvetti, great to see you, and I'll turn the floor over to you.
My great pleasure. Thank you so much, David. Hello, everybody. Very happy to be virtually with you. Hoping to be again face-to-face with you next year. Anyway, also this format, in my opinion, is very enjoyable and useful in order to exchange experiences. So let's start from the title, the 4.0. Leadership is a very well-known word. Not so easy to decline, understand, interpret, but it's very, very known word. 4.0 refers to the ongoing technological revolution. So 4.0 about this experience means working under the World Economic Forum umbrella. The guys from Davos and Geneva in Switzerland, working with a corporate university, the ENI Corporate University, or said in Italian, the ENI Corporate University, because ENI is the major energy company, conglomeration or group from Italy, and means also working with Aramco from Saudi Arabia. I assume Aramco is the biggest worldwide oil and gas company, plus other smaller companies, in order to co-design, really co-design with Barbara Bertagni, my business partner, myself, and other guys from the ENI Corporate University. We are not directly from ENI, we are independent providers from LogosNet. So it means designing something meaningful about how to foster digital mindset in order to be an effective leader, ongoing the 4.0 digital revolution. That is why the title is also Agile Mindset for a Digital Future, because this project that is ongoing is really aimed at fostering a digital mindset in young leaders, corporate young leaders, less than 40 years old, working within the energy sector and trying to really change the things, or as the guys from World Economic Forum are used to say, change the state of the world. This is the umbrella. The two names responsible for the content today, myself and Barbara, my business partner, because we co-design with the corporate university, the ENI University, the problem. And today I'm mainly sharing with you the 3 days at the beginning of the program. Then the program is online, is expected to be delivered in 9 months from the kickoff. And at the very end, we are expected to be again within the classroom. For the moment, let's focus on the 3 kickoff days because it's what we really did. For the moment, because the program is ongoing. First day, business game. Second day, scenario analysis. Third day, immersive simulation. Plus 3 speakers, 1 per day, 1 from Harvard, 1 from Stanford, 1 from MIT. Plus insights. A lot of insights. That means building a small community of practice while people are working face to face among learners and remotely with the 3 keynote speakers. So the format we designed foresee people face to face working all together for 3 days, having lunch and dinner together, plus working remotely during those 3 days with 3 keynote speakers, and then starting online modules, synchronous and asynchronous, in order to gain a deeper understanding about the takeaways from these 3 days. And these 3 days are about leadership development within the 4.0 digital age, fostering, developing, really honing an agile mindset, and understanding something about such a strange thing called the digital revolution. Because sometimes we assume that digital revolution is mainly related to the dematerialization of documents. But digital revolution is a lot more than this. It's mainly ubiquitous computing, is mainly Industry 4.0, is the Internet of Everything. A lot of sensors, nano and micro sensors, sometimes embedded within ourselves, telemedicine. Many times embedded within things, because the Internet of Everything means basically connecting sensors to sensors, to servers, analyzing what is happening and what the sensors are broadcasting in order to understand really what is happening, making correlations between a lot of data. Another key expression is big data. Big data is part of the 4.0 revolution. So, business game, first day, means immersing people within a scenario. Let's go here and then back. Within a scenario like this, that is an irreal scenario, enhanced reality, or mixed or hybrid reality. We say enhanced to skip all the fighting in between mixed and hybrid, to avoid to say that hybrid means mixed, or hybrid means something a little bit or slightly different from mixed. So we say enhanced reality, or the acronym is IREAL, and basically means allowing people to interact by the flick of their hands, as well as by spoken comments, or from only this year, by the gaze, so eye tracking, with contents usually projected on 3 walls, sometimes 4, 5, 6 surfaces, in simpler cases only 1 wall. In this case, is a standardized 3-wall pop-up because it's portable, and you are looking at a photo where a faculty from MIT is talking. on the sidewalls, people are expected to interact and to gain a better understanding about specific key topics. And first of all, to learn how to launch a cryptocurrency, because the business game we designed is about launching a cryptocurrency, learning how to sign smart contracts. Signing smart contracts means learning something about blockchain, something about the miners that are the people that are managing the blocks within the chain of the blockchain, understanding how to try to quote a new cryptocurrency in the digital world, how to use digital marketing, let's say, channels in order to promote the currency, how to avoid cyber attacks, how to keep records safe enough in order to skip the major hackers and the major risks related to the cyber attacks, and performing such a job, learning how to delegate, learning how to manage relationships that are, for the 90% of cases, virtual relationships, because the working team is expected to be split geographically, culturally, in different time zones, in different geographical areas of the world. And the people are really expected, people being part of the team, to learn and to improve the way they are able to interact each other. The way you delegate someone that you never met before is not sometimes so easy to be understood by young leaders from very traditional corporations like the oil and gas ones. They are used to work face to face and to travel in order to meet face to face. Right now, this is pretty impossible because coronavirus, but when we started, coronavirus was not in the radar. And we decided to foster a digital mindset, mainly via business game, because people from a traditional corporation are in need to learn how to lead during the 4.0 digital era. That is the main reason why we decided to engage our attendees within this type of learning environment. Performing a business game, day one, performing immersive simulations about decision making, something like an escape room within a virtualized environment, day two. Performing interaction scenario analysis, day three. Scenario analysis is something like this. Asking yourself, how is digital disrupting the automotive industry? And starting entering virtually on three walls within such a scenario. Or asking yourself something about how Shell, another oil and gas company, or other companies as well, are foreseeing 2050, are expecting to live in a few decades, expected to be totally decarbonized, or pretty totally decarbonized environment. Not fossil fuels, not at all, but renewable energies. At least 90% or more of the expected source of info. So, scenario analysis, interactive scenario analysis, means moving virtual objects from one wall to another, clustering virtual objects, opening again the boxes, the clusters, and recombining the elements. So fostering metacognitive and cognitive skills in order to try to think out of the box. It's easy to say, thinking out of the box. It's pretty challenging, mainly if you are within a highly hierarchized organization, where hierarchy is the main driver. Not at all divergent thinking or creative mindset. So those are examples. Let's go back to the one I skipped at the beginning, because this could work pretty well in order to summarize. Those are the main pillars from industry and technological revolution 4.0. Robots, so autonomous that sometimes they become cobots, collaborative robots. Cobots means not only talking to Siri or to other virtual assistants, but really working closely, physically or remotely, in a very close way with robots. Big data and analytics. Lot of data are produced today. It's really challenging, and the keynote speaker today, Ryan, was very illuminating. It's very challenging understanding which data are really meaningful. And for young leaders not directly involved with the job related to the big data analysis, at least understanding how to visualize, how to communicate internally the relevant big data, how to take decisions, how to facilitate decision making based on visualization of analytics that are big data, big amount of data. Augmented reality, maintenance, work performed on the platforms, the HoloLens, for instance, or the old Epson Movable, just to broadcast in real time what people are looking at in a different physical environment, at the same time to be delivered with info about the environment people are managing or are facing. Sometimes there are physical challenges, many times there are cultural challenges, socio-psychological challenges that partly may be faced using advice or at least information overlaid over the lenses of the HoloLens. Additive manufacturing, cloud computing and virtual computing, cybersecurity. I already told about cybersecurity. System integration, because at the end I'm talking about the integration of different systems, both within the design related to our program and within the 4.0 industry world today. Last but really not least, simulation. It's not by chance that these 3 days are basically delivered within a simulation environment, because a simulation is really important to prepare yourself in order to face the 4.0 world and the 4.0 revolution that we have all of us living today. So 3 days, going back to the very beginning, one business game, cryptocurrency. How to launch a cryptocurrency using the blockchain. Scenario analysis. How to understand what is changing within our environment from a scenario perspective. So long-term thinking, long-term perspective till 2050. Immersive simulation. Immersive simulation is also part of the business game. Immersive simulation is also part of the scenario analysis. The third day is mainly immersive simulation, or let's say, simulation, immersive simulation again, because it's an escape room to take decisions under several constraints. First of all, time-related issues and pressure that are usually challenging to face and to interact with. So this is basically our design for those 3 days, and then a platform and online learning, synchronous and asynchronous, and a final meeting expected to be again face to face. I hope to having been able to try to explain and to share with you something about our experience. I do not know if David and the team may launch the 30-second video about Irreal. Could be the right time to share with you at least 30 seconds. Thank you. And then I'm available if you have questions. This is a video, we can stop, okay? This is a video not directly related to the project I was talking about, because for privacy issues we cannot disclose participants and scenarios. But I hope you had the chance to figure out what Irreal means as an immersive simulation setting.
All right. Well, fantastic, and it's always fun to see the work that you're doing, and you know, get to see an example when it wasn't exactly an example of what we had. So there's a little bit of time. We do have the Q&A now. We have 10 minutes for questions. So if you have questions in the audience, please go ahead and put them in the chat. So we'll give a couple minutes for people to enter questions that they may have. You know, I'm curious if you can just tell us a little bit more about the simulation and how everything works. Like, you know, we saw the leadership room, we saw the room, we saw the escape room, which looks really, really cool. What can you do in there? Can you give us a little bit more detail about how the entire experience is inside that room?
Launching a cryptocurrency means talking to a lot of people face to face within your small team and remotely with other, in this case, with actors performing as colleagues from remote locations, as well as performing as providers of internet-related services like the blockchain, like Ethereum, like MetaMask. A strange word related to launching a new cryptocurrency in the online world today. So the first day people have to figure out a lot of very strange things they were not used to deal with, because they are junior leaders from the energy sector. Then the second day they are expected to have a better understanding about scenario planning, or scenario thinking, better, because the word planning is a little bit too hard in the VUCA world, volatile, uncertain, ambiguous, and really difficult to be understood by regular people world we are living in. The third day is a typical escape room, but totally virtualized, to take decisions lacking time. The three keynote speakers are online, are to really facilitate people to gain a deeper understanding about cryptocurrencies, as well as about managing a team. dynamics, behavioral dynamics, as well as how to understand scenarios for the coming 30 years. So those are the main pillars within the aerial environment in order to engage people for 3 days, plus other activities out of the room, lunch, dinner time.
And so when you mention the actors, so in the room, you're projecting, so those are, just to make sure that it's sort of clear to everybody, we've had such a mix of visual, real and virtual worlds, they're almost blending together in my own head at this point, this morning. When you're in the room, you're looking at real actors who are being projected live, and then people are able to interact with the things in the room. Is that correct, or is some of this, or do I not even have this correct?
Yes, in this case, actors are projected live, like in a video conference. They are performing lively, interacting with people. What we do sometimes is also having actors not only projected, but like avatars, 3D real-time avatars, but it's very expensive, and we cannot reach this result in a portable pop-up, because for technical reasons we need larger places in order to broadcast lively holograms that are interacting in real time. So a good output is projecting live on the walls, having the actors sometimes not so easy to be understood if they are actors or if they are avatars. Sometimes at the beginning we introduce an avatar and an actor. The actor is performing as the avatar is performing as a real human being. It's photorealistic. It takes 1 minute to be sure who is the avatar, who is the actor. And it is a good way to engage people, to have them really starting performing something.
No, this is really, really interesting. And we do have another question. Do you feel that your aerial experiences make people more forward thinking in certain ways? Is that something that you're able to measure and consider?
Frankly speaking, I hope so, but I'm not sure. Because we are lacking data about user experience. We are pretty not really able to measure the outputs from the area classroom. Only the very traditional measurement sometimes we performed. But frankly speaking, I'm not sure. So my answer is maybe, I hope, I'm not sure. We would love to really measure something in a more accurate and sophisticated way. We have to find someone able to do so. From today, I know where I have to look for, and could be the UPenn, because as I learned during the keynote speech, there is at least one person that should be really, really smart in helping us to put in place a good measurement system.
Yes, if we can connect people through ICLW, even virtually, we're all the happier. And Orion certainly seems like a really, really, really good fit. And you know, and there's so much that can be done. And I think I sort of share your, I don't want to say quite frustration, but share your feelings about wishing we were able to better evaluate things. And we have that in our own work with companies where there's, you know, we have some things that we're able to evaluate, but a lot of them, there's not budget, there's not time. The company wants to spend money on the product, and then to do, you know, and if there's an evaluation, it's more of a, you know, usually it's more of a limited one, and you don't get quite a true feel for, did this really improve performance? We have reasons to believe things improve performance based on the research, based on other projects where we have gotten to measure, but we'd love to see more measurement of the right things. And I think I have a lot of hope that some of the data that Ryan was talking about can help us get there, because the more that's collected in an automated way that we can analyze sensibly, and I say that somewhat cautiously, the better off we're going to be, right? Like, one reason we don't evaluate enough now is that it's such a time and labor intensive process to do so. And if we're able to collect some more information, we might have a chance. And so maybe that's where hopefully Ryan will be the perfect partner for you. And that's what we're hoping to do.
Hope so.
All right, terrific. Anything else? Anybody else have any other questions? We've got just about another minute or so. And Fernando will, as I mentioned, be back throughout the conference. We have other examples of his lab and some other things that he'll be talking about. So we'll get more time with Fernando throughout the next couple of days. All right. Well, Fernando, thank you so much. We're going to let you go. Before you leave, as always, when I threaten that you're going to leave, and we have one more question from Christina, which is there any particular industry that you see as being well-suited to benefiting from the eReL techniques? I know you've worked in medicine quite a bit, but are there others?
Healthcare for sure. Oil and gas, energy, automotive, finance and banking, and insurances are the existing industries and clients we are working with. And I can say those industries, in our opinion, may benefit. We would love to enter also museums, as well as other schools, but for the moment we are only able to deliver within the university and colleges, not high school or not primary schools, and we had only a couple of experiences within museums. Okay. So work in progress.
Okay. Yeah, no, absolutely. Is the limitation with the lower schools because they just don't have the rooms for you to set up in right now?
No, because we do not have the skills to deal with these type of learners.
Okay.
Because we are, first of all, tertiary education trainers. So we are pretty able, or at least at ease, with adult learning processes. And we never tried to lower the average age of our attendees. So we are in need of a good partnership with someone expert in order to enter those type of environments.
Got it. So the technology certainly lends itself to anything, and it's really just a matter of having the right expertise, which is not just a matter, but that is the area is the right expertise in children's education. And, you know, and
oh, yes, yeah. Instructional design as well.
Right, exactly. And we saw in Michelle's demo how some people may react to avatars. So you need to be prepared for whatever they might yell at the avatars if you run those. So, all right, well, terrific. Fernando, thanks again. We're going to let you go and on to the next talk. But thanks again, and we'll talk much more throughout the conference.
Thank you so much.
All right.